In this video, I will give you a brief explanation of object identities. I intend to drive you to the point where you will start loving strongly typed identities in objects you persist, and you will love them because you will know why they are good for you. Take this simple class modeling a book with its title. Not many .NET programmers are aware that this instance I made will have an identity associated. It is not just the reference. Two references pointing to the same object in memory will be equal per the reference equality rule. However, since I haven't overridden gethash code in my class, the .NET runtime will assign this instance a random number, treating it as that object's identity throughout its entire life during the current application run. You can glimpse that number if you call gethash code. Even with a garbage collector moving this object back and forth in memory, changing its reference, this identity will remain unchanged. However, this number only plays a role if I collect the books into an in-memory collection based on hashing, such as a dictionary or a hash table. It would not be suitable for persistence because that number changes every time we start the program. And so, with the advent of relational databases and the need for long-term persistence of objects, every object we create would carry an explicit identity value. We would create a brand new instance by actually not supplying the identity value. We expect the database to communicate this value back upon insertion. We use the databases to generate this value for many years, typically by taking it from an ever-increasing sequence of integer numbers. The other way to create an object was to populate the identity and everything else from the database. The database led the game, generating and then keeping an eternal identity value associated with every distinct object. This idea served us well for many years, but we needed something better. In distributed databases and services, plain auto-increment sequences of numbers would cause collisions. That is how we got the habit of using globally unique numbers. It was of lesser importance which end would generate them this time. It could be the database again, or it could be the application. The database just lost any role but to keep the data safe on disk. But the times, they kept changing. Our appetites grew. What if there was another entity in the model? That above was the book and every book has one or more authors. We could follow the same protocol up to the point when we realized that there must be a foreign key to indicate the book this author wrote. Now look at this code, what do you see? I'll tell you what some people saw in it. Confusion. It only takes a minute to wreck this code. Suppose that there is some data source such as entity framework or whatever else. Given a persistent identity of a book, we could write a method somewhere deep in our application that performs a sensitive business operation on that book. Find it in the database, obtain the object, then do stuff to it. Does this look familiar? I will make an example book object, the object-oriented software construction, authored by Bertrand Meyer. I will warmly suggest every programmer to find and read this book. Hence, I will advertise it via this ingenious method I have. Isn't this nice? I can do anything I like in the application so long as I know the identity of any object I plan to fetch from the database. But one day, one Friday afternoon, I'll be tired and my beer will be getting warm, waiting for me to come to the bar. There will be a tiny feature to write something to fix right now, right here, and I will do it swiftly. I've got no time to read the documentation, no time to open up the method I'm calling to figure out what it does. So I'll make a quick bug instead. How did I pass the wrong ID to the method? Oh, it's easy when there is no machine to warn me about the problem. The compiler is fine with this because all it checks is the variable type. And that one is correct, it is GUID, just as requested. Hence the idea that will change the shape of identities forever. Before that, here's a small reminder that you can always like this video, especially if you don't like the buggy code I made so far. Subscribe for more and then visit me on Patreon. By becoming a patron, you get access to the source code from this video and all other videos, as well as the preview of my future course on programming with C#. Back to that great idea. Why not make a separate type that identifies a book so that any other identity becomes unassignable to it? Here is how it works. I'm defining a placeholder type that will evolve into a proper strongly typed identity type. As of now, it is empty, but still, it is a type. Therefore, assignment rules apply to it. Many things are missing here, but one is there. The object assignment check is back in the game. Now we're talking. The sleeper has awakened. Hey compiler, where have you been so long? There's an error in the second call. I'm unable to make that silly mistake this time. This is why you will want to have a strongly typed identity in your persistent objects. This is a common practice in DDD, but you can adopt it in any project whatsoever, even when you don't apply domain-driven design. There are a few considerations though. Any identity you define must be a value object supporting equality tests based on its actual value. That means that a custom strong identity should contain some value that is a legitimate database key. GUID comes to mind again. A custom strong key can be a thin wrapper around a plain GUID value. You will see programmers use C# records for that. Records are easy to define, they are immutable, and they come with value type semantics out of the box. There's only one issue with this approach. A record, as defined here, is a class. Therefore, I have substituted a value type with a reference type, causing a needless allocation and garbage collection. You can remove that issue if you declare this identity as a record struct. There is a corollary to this. Make sure to declare it a read-only record struct. Only then will the instance be immutable. Hence, this strong book identity is an immutable value type that wraps a database-supported GUID, applies value-typed semantics to it, and makes no allocation and garbage collection overhead. We could benefit from such helpers as having an empty book ID or a fresh, unique one. Go up and define these two specific members on the book identity class. Your code will look nice with these shiny details. In case you have missed the evolutionary nature of this demo, let me point you to one aspect that I find very intriguing. Do you know that old story about the evolution of eating habits? Like cavemen were thinking if there will ever be something to eat? Medieval men worked for money and used it to buy food around. And a modern man asks where the buffet table is so they can pick and choose according to their liking. Strongly typed identities are the buffet table of modern persistence design. They bridge the gap between the storage which supports serializable plain types such as GUID and applicative code which operates on types. Enjoy your life, go with your friends, have a nice evening. You'll never be able to make an assignment bug on identities. This completes the backing theory and a practical implementation that really works. You can use this recipe with entity framework, which can easily map this book ID type, or you can use any micro-ORM for that purpose. Here you can find the entire application built with custom strong identities used with entity framework core. This is the full book model used in a real web application. There we find its strongly typed primary key, but also the nullable foreign key for the many-to-one relationship with the publisher, as well as an entire collection modeling a many-to-many relationship with the book's authors. It all works with the entity framework. You can always download the source code from my Patreon page, so let me invite you once again to support this channel and become a patron. Enjoy learning!